Welcome to the third part of Terraform for Java Developers. I'm Julien Dubois. You can follow me on Twitter at Julien Dubois, and I am leading the Java Developer Advocacy team at Microsoft. In this four-part series, we have been talking about Terraform from a Java developer's perspective, and we are currently on part three, Terraform tools and best practices. If you want to watch the other videos, they are available on our YouTube channel. Now let's get back to where we stopped in the previous part. So we created a MySQL database with some firewall, but we all did that by copy-pasting samples around the documentation, and we have not followed any best practices. So let's stop and have a look at how we can improve that in order to be able to go to the next step, which will be in the last part, where we will do something more complex, but we first must follow a few best practices in order to make our code more readable and to have more tooling. So first, let's talk about styling and the structure of our code. So we already saw the first best practice that I want to introduce here is we've been using tags here. So this is totally optional, and most code providers are providing those. So you can do any tags here. I'm usually creating a tag called Terraform that I'm putting to true, which means that if I go to the Azure portal, here it is. If I go to my resource group, I can see that my resource group is tagged with Terraform true. And I know that I should not manage those resources manually, because if I do that, I'm going to mess up the state of my resources. And Terraform will not be able to perform correctly its job. That's just a trick. Nothing is mandatory here, but I hugely recommend you to tag your resources with Terraform when you want them managed by Terraform, so you can tell your tools, or when you do things manually, that you know for yourself that you should not manually change those resources, and you should go through Terraform to do those. So that was my first best practice. The second one is to better indent your code. This has been copy-pasted from the documentation, so it's a little bit better than that what I created earlier by myself. So usually people working with Terraform are indenting their code this way. They're aligning all the equal signs because that way it is easier to read. I'm going to do the same here. And you will quickly see that it's easier to understand your code if all of those are aligned. So let me just do it a little bit more just to give you an example. But that's the best practice that everybody in the Terraform community is following. Third best practice is to split up those attributes by meaning. So usually I put the three at the top all the time. It's the name of my resource in Azure. So usually you always have a name for all your resources. Then I have its location. You want its data center all the time. And then the resource group. Always your resources are belonging to a resource group. So you always want those three things at the top usually to understand its ID, its location, and its group. That's for all resources. And then I'm splitting attributes with blank lines so I can better see what they mean. So for a MySQL server here, I would put the login and password outside of the rest because I know that those are things that I want to have a look at. And usually I would put all the other attributes like this at the end. You can order them alphabetically or by type. There's no strict rule here. So that was the third best practices I wanted to tell you about, is to order your attributes by meaning. Last thing here, I have been hard coding some variables in my code. Usually that's not a good practice. I'm committing this into Git because I'm working with other people. Probably the other people do not want to deploy to WestUp, and probably they don't want the same resource group name as myself. So those should be variables. So let me create another file here, which I'm going to call variables.tf. And inside this file, I can create a new variable. So let me call it a location. What is interesting here is that for this variable, I can do a description. I couldn't have this earlier. Well, you can have code comments, but it's better to have an attribute like this. So description is like the data center to use. And I also can put a default value, which would be West Europe. So if people do not want to set up that variable, they will have the same as me. And now I can delete this here and type var.location. And I'm going to use now the location, which is described in my variables file. So it's always better to separate variables like this, because when somebody takes up your code, it will be very easy for him to understand that variables is where your variables are, and it will have a description and a default value. So that will make his life a lot easier. As we're talking about best practices, let's talk also about tooling. We've seen that Terraform has got a tool called state, so I can do state list. And this is going to list what's inside my Terraform infrastructure. But this is not really easy to read. You don't really understand here that the firewall depends on the server, for example. And to better understand this, Terraform has got another tool called Terraform Graph. Let me run this. This is outputting in ASCII format some data. So this is called a digraph, and this can be used by various tools, the most common one being GraphViz. So there is an online version of it. Let me go there and paste what I have just copied. And as you can see, this is creating a graph of my resources. So Terraform, in fact, does not list your resources. Basically, it does a graph of them. And as you can see here, my MySQL server, well, depending on that server, you have the firewall role and you've got the database, which is correct indeed. And this gives me a better vision of my infrastructure. By the way, I do not recommend using GraphViz. There is a much better tool for that, which is called BlastRadius, which I'm going to run here locally first, BlastRadius. So this is an open source tool. And when you run it, it's going to give you here a graphical view of your infrastructure, which is better than GraphViz because it's tagging stuff. It understands Terraform, in fact. So this tool is going to give you a much better vision of what you are doing. And when a little bit later we are going to add more resources, you will see it's going to help us a lot to better understand what depends on what here. For example, my firewall role, it doesn't depend on the database, it depends on the server. That's interesting to know. And here we can see the variable we just created before. So that's a very handy tool to better understand what's happening when you are doing a change in your Terraform file. So it's called BlastRadius, and you can install it. It's open source. I will give the link in the description of this video. Last but not least, Terraform is providing an online version which is called Terraform Cloud. Let's go to terraform.io and click on the cloud. This is a web version of what we have been doing online with the command line. It's another way to use it. It's more graphical, but of course you are uploading your code to the cloud now. Let me just show you how it works. I'm going to create a new workspace using my GitHub account. And I'm going to use my Spring Pet Clinic fork. So as you didn't see it, here it is. I'm going to configure this with advanced options because my working directory is called Terraform and I am working in a branch which is deployed to Azure. So let me create the workspace. And so this is going to understand my Terraform configuration and this is going to allow me to run my Terraform scripts from the cloud. So it's probably going to make it easier for me and more graphical, and I will not rely on my laptop to execute my Terraform script. So you can configure some variables or just run it. This is not going to run because I didn't allow it to create resources on Azure, of course. So I'm going to have an application error here, but as you can see, this would have executed the exact same Terraform configuration as the one I have done locally on my laptop. So that's another good tool if you like to use Terraform because it's more graphical. So in this section, we have seen a number of best practices and tools. We're going to use them to improve our code in the next section. The next section will be about deploying our application in the cloud for real. So we have just created the database. In the next video, we're going to deploy also our Java application server and we will deploy everything to Azure. And at the end, we will have a running, fully running application on Azure thanks to Terraform. Thank you.